Good afternoon and a warm welcome to INTAC in the new year. Today we have as our guest speaker Dr. Suptendu Biswas, who is an architect, urban designer, planning professional involved in consultancy, teaching, research and writing for almost three decades. He works on overlapping fields, design and planning of built environment, urban services, landscape urbanism, heritage and social and cultural studies. His multifaceted works have been presented, published and exhibited in India and abroad. He has worked as a key consultant for Jaipur Smart City Project and taught as visiting faculty in postgraduate courses at SPA Delhi, that School of Planning and Architecture. He is a member of Doctoral Review Committee of SPA Bhopal and one of the founder trustees of SURCH, a Kolkata-based charitable trust working on urban sustainability and related spheres. His critically acclaimed book, Assorted City, was shortlisted among the five best urban writings in 2016-17. He also co-edited Blue Lines of Kolkata, a book on ideas and proposals on canals in Kolkata. He was a recipient of the prestigious Senior Fellowship from Ministry of Culture, Government of India, under which he researched on festivals of the Sunderbans. As you would know that Sunderbans is the largest mangrove belt of the world and was according to the UNESCO World Heritage Site in 1987. And the presentation today will discuss festivals of the Sunderbans to understand how people and nature interact inseparably to shape culture of the place. So, Dr. Biswas, over to you now. And welcome to INTAC once again.
Thank you very much for inviting me here. Because this is something which is very close to me, because this is one of the places where this is my ancestral house, was very close to this place in Sundarban, not really in Sundarban, but within that area, or a little outside of it. The Sundarbans, actually, I'm giving a little bit of introduction to it. Up to year 1770, this total area of Sundarban of India and Bangladesh, which is there's a part of Bangladesh also, it's two-thirds of Sundarban is in the Bangladesh now. This was estimated about 36,000 square kilometer, which at present stands to be around 25,000 square kilometer. To put it in the perspective, this will be like half of the size of Punjab state. So that is how big it is. Indian part is about, more than 9,000 square kilometer. It's less than 45% of the total area, and almost 6.5 times of the area of Delhi. So that is just to put it in a kind of a perspective, how big it is. Most of the upper part of Sundarban, which is near Calcutta or near the mainland, those are accessed by roads. Large number of people also commute daily by suburban railways, which connects them to Calcutta, but it has a very limited network. In the southern part of Sundarbans, ferry or boat is the only mode of transport between islands. Let's look at a bit of history for us to understand certain aspects of this place. After the Battle of Plassey in 1757, East India Company got the title of Calcutta, and then after 1764, they got the tax administration and the property rights from the Nawab of Bengal for 24 Parganas. 24 Parganas, Sundarban was part of 24 Parganas, and it is still now. This was the beginning of the colonial rule in India. The first act of the tax collection has always been survey and mapping, and collector general planned conversion of forest land to agriculture land, which could then be taxed. Lots were formed in Sundarban. There is nothing called plots, these are called lots. So lots were formed and planned reclamation started. That is why you can see in this Google Earth image, as opposed to most of the other forest areas, Sundarban land is in regular shape. It's almost like drawn on a drawing board. Even this recent Google map shows that, Google image. This is the lower part of Sundarbans next to the forest. The lot configurations are clearer here. But as and when one go up, little up northern part of Sundarbans, over a period of time, the land parcel also got subdivided. Yet you can see the geometry within it. One key moment at that point of time was the permanent settlement, an agreement between the East India Company and the landlords in Bengal. This was around 1786 to 93, this whole process have happened. And this was made to fix the revenues, fixed revenues from the land, and jamindars were created. This is like almost the beginning of the middleman coming into the picture. So institutionalized the middleman system in India, that is the beginning of it. So this had a very little portion of the Britishers, East India Company, jamindars, and the huge number of peasants or farmers. This settlement had far-reaching consequences for both agricultural methods and productivity in the British Empire. Fixed revenues were collected by native landlords, and this division created the people who have the land, the landowners, and the people who did not have the land and who are working for others. So this was a major division which happened, and later that has tremendous implications in other peasants' uprisings and so on and so forth. After mapping and lot cutting, boundary was marked in 1828, named after two engineers who drew it, Dampier and Hodges. This line till today, demarcates the boundary of the Sundarbans. So this is the line what one can see, the red line which I have marked. This was a very critical phase. This line demarcated the forest land, and all land outside the line were brought under cultivation and also the permanent settlement. The purpose was to collect revenue. It was like the Lal Dora of Sundarbans. So the line was drawn like that. Later, the land clearing happened even within this line. So as one can see, this is the line. Just show the color. So at this moment, this is where the Sundarban starts. But this is where now all the settlements happened. So earlier this used to be forest, but now this has become the settlement. So land clearing happened over a period of time. So survey, mapping, settlement, agriculture, taxation, then the accessibility. Railway line came in Canning. There is a place called Canning. In fact, it came in 1863. Interestingly, it came before Delhi-Calcutta line. Delhi-Calcutta line came in 1866. Canning till today is called Port Canning. Canning is somewhere here. I mean, if we look at this, this is Calcutta and this is Canning. So it is very close to the Sundarban gateway kind of area. Amitabh Ghosh in his book Hungry Tyree talks about it in great detail. So Canning today is still called Port Canning. This was one of the places where the Britishers wanted a second port out of Calcutta and started PPP model of development at that point of time. But what happened is very, very soon there was a cyclone, and because of which the whole port structure got dismantled, and they dropped that idea of it. So, and slowly they gave back the land they gave it back, or the money they gave it back. And there was a huge process how this Port Canning redevelopment happened and how Port Canning settlement happens after that when the redevelopment did not happen. With all these, they started recording the data, information and statistics, therefore the making of the gazetteer in 1875. Another important instrument of governmentality, the more I see it, more it reminds me of Michel Foucault. He talks about the techniques of governmentality, and that is how the colonial rule started, and everywhere they worked on this line. In 1875, gazetteer Sir W.W. Hunter mentions that the geography and the riverine fabric of Sundarban parts can be distinguished in three regions defined by rivers. So here we are discussing up to even today's Bangladesh is also included within that. So one part is 24 Parganas, from Hooghly River, that is the tributary of Ganges, and Raimungal River is where the Indian border ends at this point of time. Then the Khulna part, which is Raimungal to Baleshwar River, where even today when I have gone there last year, I have seen that this whole area was earlier marshy land, and Hunter talked about that there will miles after miles it was completely empty, nobody was staying there. And till today, even there is a single story building are being built at that place, they use pile foundation. So this is the status. So it's like number of layers which they found when they did the piling. Some of the architects told me. Then there is a third part, which is Baketganj part, which is next to the Meghna river. The land was high, and it was a much better place. So he explained that how people are wealthy and they have good agriculture produce and so on and so forth. So the three broad regions also gave three different kind of livelihood and three different kind of cultural aspects. Now if we concentrate in the Sundarbans of in the Indian part of Sundarbans, there are some figures which are there. I'll just put it in a perspective. Indian part of Sundarbans constitutes of 19 administrative blocks. The reserve forest has shrunk now to less than 50%. Yet 60% of total mangrove area of the whole country is a mangrove forest is in Sundarbans, and almost 90% of the species are there in this mangrove forest. In terms of wetland, 20% area is wetland, which is 1.3 times size of Delhi. So the wetland in Sundarbans. So it's sometimes when I put out the kilometer square, it's very difficult for many people to understand. When you say that, okay, it's 1.5 times more than Delhi, then one can understand what one is talking about. Then primary occupation remains to be agriculture, supported by fishery, forestry, and handicraft. The non-worker population in 1991 was 70% non-worker, with 3% part-time worker and 27% main worker. However, only 10% of these main workers were employed in agriculture as laborers and as cultivators, and the rest of the 10% as laborers. So also the participation of female workers is very low, indicating complete gender inequality as well in this area. This observation talks about that in general, people are very poor. They are ecosystem people whose living primarily depends on natural resources around. There are three important occupations for Sundarban people. One is wood cutting, second is honey gathering, third is fishing. And planning data do not understand this kind of occupation. Therefore, they are non-workers. Such an ecologically sensitive region is also quite populated. As per 2001 census, population was 37.56 lakhs. 1999-2001 decadal growth means in 10 years the growth of population was 17%. Interestingly, decadal growth was higher even in 81-91. One reason for that was Morichappi incidents in 1979. People like me who have grown up in that area in 80s could actually recall that there are almost like 1.5 Dalit refugees came from Dandakaranya, which is present Chhattisgarh, to resettle back in. Those are Bengali refugees. They came to West Bengal, and they went to Morichappi. There was an island in Sundarbans. They wanted to settle there. Out of this 1.5 lakhs, 40,000 wanted to settle. Rest of them dispersed within the West Bengal area. So at that point of time, those 40,000 people were forcefully evicted by the then left front government. The death toll could have been any number between 100 to thousands. One of the reasons was to protect the natural heritage. This is a story, this Morichappi story needs a completely different discussion altogether. It's quite relevant these days. Many people will discuss it for some point of time. But what happens was that 2 years later, Sundarban got wildlife sanctuary status. It was in the process of getting national park status and finally the World Heritage Tag in 1987. Many argue I mean, people like Anuja Lais and all, people who have worked significantly on Sundarbans, they argue that people's life was compromised in order to save wildlife. So that was the story of Monish Jhapi. Coming back to the main discussion, Indian part of Sundarbans also indicates three broad zones from east to west, each defined by major rivers. And these rivers are about 4 to 5 kilometer wide in some area, I mean in areas, 4 to 5 kilometer wide, I mean, and it goes even bigger and wider when it goes and meets the Bay of Bengal. So this is one zone from Hooghly River. Hooghly means this is where the Ganges meets the sea. This is where the Sagar Island is, where the Ganga Sagar festival happens, which is one of the most important festivals. I'll discuss that. So this is one river. To the next one, it's called Matla River. I mentioned about Port Canning, which is adjacent, I mean, which is on the bank of this river. They're huge rivers. Then there is a Vidyadhari River, which is one of the oldest rivers, which has a lot of settlements around. And this is the center point of Sundarban, from where you need to take the boat and cross it. There's no other way one can cross this, go to the Sundarban areas. And then the Raimangal, which is at the border between India and Bangladesh. And this is one of the largest rivers I have seen in Lower Bengal. So with that, this accessibility also contributes. These are the red dots of the railway, main the railway stations, railway points, so gateways of Sundarbans. And it almost works like a finger or hand. So you are connected almost, I mean, you are connected from the mainland through the through these railway lines, but you are not connected with the next finger or the next portion. So this is how it happens, and the culture also developed in that way. So each portions from the eastern to the western side, they have a very distinct pattern because of the accessibility and their connectivity with Calcutta and the mainland. This brings to another special. There is another point also, because one comes as a gateway to Sundarbans, it brings another special divide, which is north-south divide. One is east-west, another one is north-south. The up islands and the down islands. There are two kinds of islands. The yellow shows the up island, this area shows the up island, and this is the down island. So up island and down islands, they have different geographies and social practices, and therefore they are different cultures. Up islands are part of stable delta. They have better access to Calcutta. These areas were deforested and cultivated by 1900, it was complete. And the higher ground level makes them safer, and fertility of the soil, better irrigation, and not so saline water works for agriculture. And agriculture become their main occupation. Therefore, popular rituals and festivals are centered around agricultural season and related mythologies. For example, there's a festival called Gajan. Up islands are parts, this is the stable delta part which I was mentioning. Down islands are colloquially known as Abad. I mean, in Bengali, there are a lot of people mention this as Abad, and they means that, you know, somebody who comes from a very rustic background, they call this is from Abad. So this is how it, people in a larger cities, they, I mean, in cities like Calcutta, they look at Sundarbans in this manner. So these areas were reclaimed, that the green area which I'm showing here, reclaimed between 1900 to 1980, around this time, and inhabited by about 5 million people. These areas located on the edge of mangrove forest, active delta, the land are often made, destroyed, and remade by nature. Life is very tough here, and reclamation is a struggle against many odds. I mean, the way they live also, it's a very, very difficult kind of life they lead around that point of time. Since I am discussing Sundarbans, this is the next part. I thought that I'll show Royal Bengal Tiger, because that is the most iconic identity maker of this place. Though I haven't seen it, I have been to so many, I mean, been there so many times. Fortunately or unfortunately, I didn't see it. What I saw was the mark, the pug marks, which most of us could see. So tiger is an omnipresent spirit here. Often we hear stories about it. that tend to become the myth around the local people. Real presence of the tiger is only seen in the footprints that the animal leaves behind. So there are a lot of stories, lot of rituals. Near forest area is centered around the tiger itself. Then there is mangrove forest and the river. This relationship changes along with the low tide and the high tide. So when the water comes in from Bay of Bengal, the water rises up and then it recedes. So it changes, the landscape changes. So this is a photograph of the high tide picture. During high tide, the Sundarban looks absolutely green, the blue and the green. Then when water starts receding or reducing, then slowly one can see this is when the water just started reducing. And then it exposes the mud flats where you have the boats and other things. So then it becomes very brown and green kind of combination. Then river is the ethos of Sundarban. I mean, this is something which one must understand about Sundarban. The whole life revolves around it. And it contributes the key element of the ecology. This is the photograph of how river winds through the forest. Then the settlements. Settlements are next to the river. River is the main access route, so people get down to the jetty and go to their house. So this is the relationship between the river and the settlement. And the main access routes. For the main access routes, people use the Arden Bandh that stops the river water to come in. In fact, during high tide, the river swell above the groundwater of the settlement. So the settlement is, groundwater is low, river water is high. So, these mud dams is what hold the life of Sundarban. Because if it breaks, the whole thing will be flooded and whole thing will be gone. And Sundarban has about 4,250 kilometer length of river embankment, little less than the distance between Delhi to Istanbul by flight. I mean, that's the length actually one is talking about. So there are agricultural fields. So I'm talking about how the landscape is and how things are. This is an agricultural field, large, this is a high, and there are aquaculture, there are the fisheries, which is also an important economy in Sundarban areas. Then there are brick fields, and which also is quite significant in this landscape of this area. Then there is the small huts and the villages nestles within the landscape with the coconut trees and all. So these are some of the life in the settlements. This is how the houses are. Then there will be pond from which they will catch the fish and then they eat the fish. From the agriculture field, they will get the rice and then they eat. So they're almost like a self-sustaining kind of situations. Then they will have the vegetables, they will cook. And this is important because I thought very few people have seen this. This is how the cooking happens in many places in this country. So these houses become festive in Christmas with the help of Rangoli pattern that we generally associate with Hindu festivals. The whole community participates in festivals like Christmas. And this particular area, this Gosaba, is a very important area. I mean, there can be a separate discussion on this. This place is, there's a historically a sizable population of Christians and there are churches and things like that. Gosaba was taken up by an Irish, Daniel Hamilton, in the beginning of 20th century and was a testing ground of the cooperative movement in India. The cooperative movement started in Europe around that time. Hamilton was an idealist Irish, and he told officially that, you know, the Britishers are not, they don't know how to run the place, and he took this land and he started looking at that as an excellent initiative. For 2 decades he ran it, completely took the middlemen out and so on and so forth. Tagore also visited this place and he wanted to have a collaboration with Hamilton. So there are a lot of nuanced learning one can take from Hamilton's Gosaba initiative, which I will leave for another day. And this particular one I found is interesting, not because it's a photograph of mine, but because this is the same Durga Puja gate which or a marriage gate gets appropriated by putting a cross on top. So it is So this church is at the background, one can see. So the universal festival gets contextualized here. So I happened to talk to a young man there in 90, he was in his 30s, so he was like, he was working in Chennai and he came back. He's a Hindu guy and he came back to Sundarban for this festival, and we were visiting there. And so so he said that this is their festival, because it's a festival that happens, though he said that though I am Hindu, but this is like my festival, because we enjoy it. So in comparison, so this is a festival where you have a global festival gets contextualized with Rangolis and all that. And on the other hand, there is a festival of Ganga Sagar Mela, which is one of the largest in Sundarban, which I mentioned, which is essentially not the festival of this place, of Sundarban. So it is locally placed, but with a reach of outsider, reach to the outsider. So there are different kind of festivals happen. So this brings me to the part three of the discussion. So this is religion, this thing in Bengali, this is called religion is for individuals, festival for all. This is a simple translation of the Bengali version of one of the most inclusive messages I have ever come across. Saw it on the walls of Dhakeshwari Temple in Dhaka. And this discussion, which I am going to do, perhaps can move along such a conceptual contour. Also interesting is an anecdote from a recent text, Identity and Composite Culture, the Bengal case, published in the Journal of the Asiatic Society of Bangladesh in 2013. It was written by Professor Sushil Chaudhuri. Professor Chaudhuri was an eminent historian of 18th century Bengal. He poses this critical question and explains through an anecdote, which I find relevant in today's discussion. He goes on saying, almost the same story which I also said, in 1960s, he was traveling in the Diden Santal Parganas, and which is now in Jharkhand, when he saw a group of Santals who were Christians sacrificing hens at the altar of their popular god. So he asked, how could you do this? Because you are Christians. They replied back saying in Bengali, which means that we may be Christians, but how can we be oblivious of our religion, that is Dhammo? So which is not exactly the religion which we talk about. So this is rather quite instructive. Here, religion is not what many people made it out to be these days, but a way of life as much as culture is. And the two mingle and overlap at some point. One cannot be separated from the other completely. It is true in the case of Sundarbans as well, where religions conjoin with syncretic relations and become a part of life. The existing discourses on Sundarbans essentially involve two broad realms. On one hand, scientific discussions on the environment. Community is seen as the victims facing desperate outcome or desperate future. And on the other hand, there are narratives that form mythologies, how beliefs and rituals shape the rich culture of a place. Such intellectual threads are often mutually exclusive. Environmental and climate change discussions demonstrate in a sophisticated way scientific evidences and provide a bird's eye view of what could be in store, whereas local culture-based observations cling onto the narratives of uniqueness of the place. On the other axis, the state and the community form two ends of collective living, of generality and specificity. Community is unstructured, rudimentary structured, or relatively undifferentiated, whereas state is a structured, impersonal entity. The Sundarbans exist between these two notions. Now, if we look at this particular matrix, I mean, particular the Cartesian kind of a diagram, state environment quarter, that is this quarter, talks about the policies and programs. So if we look at Sundarban whole discourse, we can put it in this. Then state mythology quadrant talked about festival tourism promotions and initiatives. There are many things which happens, the government also does, based on the mythology and the festivals. And whereas festival and the culture of Sundarbans put community at the center and overlap between the environment and mythology, from environment-dependent occupation to mythology-loaded ritual practices. and therefore it cuts across, the festivals cuts across and the culture cuts across the Cartesian geometry. So I looked at many festivals. I don't want to discuss this here, and so many of them. Some of them I'll touch upon. In Bengali, we call 13 festivals in 12 months. That is how the life is in this lower part, lower Bengal. There are two periods when major festivals happen. One is Makar Sankranti, which is happening now. Even 1914 gazetteer also listed several of these festivals. So this is the Makar Sankranti festival. All the festivals happen. There are a large number of festivals happens here. Ganga Sagar Mela is one of the biggest one. In 1914, it was recorded to have 30 to 50,000 people. So now it goes in lakhs. In fact, Ganga Sagar Fair is the second largest congregation in the world after Kumbh Mela, and it happens every year, with lakhs of people taking the holy dip near during Makar Sankranti. This is where the river Ganges meet the Bay of Bengal. A dip at this place is supposed to wash away the sins. No wonder more and more people are flocking there to take a dip. However, this is not the festival of Sundarban, not of his folk culture. It's a Brahminical festival attended by many from various parts of India. So that's not one of the major ones. The other period is Chaitra Sankranti, which is during the beginning of Bengali New Year. Not only Bengali New Year, there are all New Years across India. That's the New Year. That is the harvesting time. That is the summer festival. So there are a number of festivals happens around that time. One of the largest festival is known as Gajan. So I have just put the map there with a red dot showing where I have observed this. And this happens everywhere. But this is particular area which I am explaining here. So Gajan actually happens in summer and almost at the end of the Bengali New Year and beginning of the New Year. This is considered as a spring ritual. This festival celebrates and motivates the act of revival and in turn the notion of fertility in the fields, in the waters, and in the family. So that is the notion of this festival. People from different villages join together for this festival. In other parts of rural Bengal, this also takes place, but that has a different kind of rituals. Such a festival is completely, I mean, almost unknown outside Bengal, but involves lakhs of rural Bengalis for a week or more in every spring. Lord Shiva is in the folk form is at the center of Gajan festival. It's not the North Indian Shiva. It is a completely different kind of Shiva, the look and the way it is dealt with. This is the Shiva festival. People take holy dip in the tank, take parikrama, stand in the queue to give offerings, light the fire by symbolically burning the old to usher the new beginning. It is a festival of the subalterns. Traditionally, the lower caste people. During this period of Gajan, they wear sacred threads, as you can see, many of them wearing around their neck, and assume a self-imposed hardship with a belief that it could bring them close to God. The festival gathering also has mela, food joints, and many other local crafts. A large social gathering for the active participants and also for the visitors. So if you look at a space organization like this, one can see that there will be a water body from which they will take the dip, then they will go into the area, then they will go to the ritual area, they do the rituals, they go to the temple, then come back, go to the mela, and then they go back. So this is the major parikrama. It happens everywhere. I mean, in most of the temples it happens in a formal system. This is a makeshift sacred place. It's made for only this. Then there is another interesting festival which I have observed. This is a place called Dhaptapi. This is also in Up Island. This is towards Calcutta side. So there is a god called Dakhin Rai. I have never seen a god with a gun in his hand. So this is a god with a gun in his hand. It's called Dakhin Rai. It is believed that he was a jamindar and a hunter who saved many people from the tigers. Interestingly, Dakhin Rai is also name of a tiger demon. I will discuss in the lower part of Sundarban. So it changes. It changes also with the community. Here, the Dakhin Rai is God. So this Dakshinai, when it is demon, it's like a human form of, almost like a demonish form of tiger. Anyway, I'll come to that. So here also one looks at the space, the tank. One takes the dip and then go to Parikrama and then go back to the courtyard. And from that, then one goes to the temple. So everywhere these ad hoc arrangements are created. So this tank is not really greatly sacred or anything, but this is meant to be sacred, is next to the temple and things like that. So they pour water on the tulsi plant in the temple courtyard and pray to God. So this is almost like any other temple in a conventional way the puja happens, of a very, very unconventional god. So Dakshinayana puja, this puja is also similar to Lord Shiva. It happens around that time only. It is around Rajan time only. In that sense, Dakshinayana is the Shiva of the people of this part. And he will protect them from demons, traditionally the tiger. Although the forest line moved far away from this place, but this belief continued with the people there. And they still believe, they go there, put the thread and things like that. Then there is one mazar, it's called Ghutiari Sharif. This is one of the biggest icons of this area, Mubarak Shah Ghazi. He is like one of the Sufi person. And during Ambubachi is there is a huge festival in this area. Ambubachi is a festival which is famous in Kamrup Kamaksha temple, which is a festival of Shakti, it's a festival of ladies. Very interestingly, this becomes a very important festival in this place. And many people, not only Muslims, all across come here and do puja. Ghazi was patronized by a Hindu Jamindar. And the prasad of this festival is called Shirni, and which is almost like Firni, and which actually becomes Sinni in some of the other Hindu gods. The same prasad becomes Sinni. So Firni to Sirni to Sinni, it is completely the way they do it, the way prasad is made, it is completely cross-cultural syncretism, the way it happens. So Ghutiari Sharif is one of the most important Sufi mazar in Lower Bengal. So here also relationship is the same. This is called Makka Pukur. So this is a very important pond in which even the people come across religion. They come to do mannat here, to pray to God, the Ghazi Baba, and they say that, okay, if there's for fertility, if for children, and if they have the child after that, they will. There's a very interesting system. There's a big, a huge katori kind of a thing or a utensil in which they will put the small kid, a child, and then they will float it on the water with a thread, and then they will take it back and things like that. So there's a system, it goes on for a very long time, and etc. So they also have the similar kind of spaces across the way we have seen the temples. Here also we see court, from the court to the mazar and the mosque. So everybody goes and tries to take a little bit of water. This gentleman went with me. He actually is a priest in one of the Shiva temples. So he went there, took the water. So that's how the people think, and that's how people live there. Another unique festival here is Goshtha Mela, which happens in 2nd of Boishak, which is the second day of Bengali New Year. This is in the lower part of Sundarban. This festival takes place on the agricultural field around 11th century Shiva temple, all made in brick, known as Jotar Deul. Jota means the hair, like Shiva hair, and Deul means the temple, the house or the abode of the god. This is the only protected ASI structure in South Chobbish Parganas, 24 Parganas. Around 50,000 people gather here in this festival. Out of nowhere, this festival happens. The main attraction of this festival is the horse racing, happening for more than 100 years, even more. The people who are very old, they said 100 years, even it goes on more than that. Young jockeys come from neighboring areas. The dry agricultural field becomes the racing arena. Very interesting, because this is the time all the produce is cut, the field is clean, and this happens. It could have happened in any other time, but it happens at this time. Across all age, gender, religion, and class of people, they attend it. In that sense, this is truly a participatory event, community that goes beyond this religious line. However, the most important divinity in this down island of Sundarbans is called Bonbibi. The name of the goddess itself suggests that she is a Muslim, but she dresses like a Hindu, and also she changes. She looks almost like in her idols are more like Lakshmi idols in many places. That changes accordingly where the Bonbibi puja happened. And she epitomizes the syncretism. Bonbibi, there are, in one altar, there are many gods. The Hindu gods like Dokhin Rai, there are Muslim gods like Gaji Sahib and etc. So one knows that in Muslim religion that they don't have this form. But at this place, when they enter into the jungle, then all the forms come together and then becomes one platform everywhere. And everybody across their religion, they pray to God. So when they go for fishing and wood cutting or honey gathering, which is a very risky job, all of them will come there, pray, and then they will go. Myth or legend suggests that Bonbibi came from Persia and settled here and made this place free from the tyranny of the tiger demon called the Kinrai. And there are a lot of mythologies, the folklores and all that is there of this, which talks about, and there are detailed analysis of that. Idols also, as I discussed, take form and style of other idols which are nearby. In some places where there are Muslim-dominated area, Bonbibi dresses differently. In Hindu-dominated area, Bonbibi dresses differently. So she has this eclectic nature of taking up, and one of the most revered gods. From north to south, as you can see in the map, the north to south, the presence of Bonbibi can be seen across Sundarbans. Even the government establishment, this is the government establishment, this area. This is made by the government, the state. That forest also recognized her divinity power, her power to save people. So Bonbibi Than in Bengali and Bonbibi Temple, where everybody will pray before they enter into the forest. And along with Bonbibi, there will be other gods. So more the better, more the merrier, because they are actually going to a very difficult place. The festival includes cultural programs like Jatra, that is the folk theater. There are farmers and fishermen. These people, they are farmers and fishermen. During daytime, they work on the field, and during evening, they become the gods and demons. So social gathering and entertainment are important ingredients. Main festival happens at this time during Makar Sankranti, which is around that time. The script of Bonbibi mantra written in Bengali, and it is like Urdu, it from the back to the front. So one needs to read it from the back to the front, written in Bengali. No Brahmin priests for the puja. Whoever could read would do the puja, and everyone in the team entering the forest will participate. And that is irrespective of their religion. In front of fear and death, all have common concern. That is the protection of life. So this brings me to the end of the presentation. The overall spatial structure, if we see in all four of that, which we have just jotted down, it follows the sequential activity pattern from arrival to the holy deep, in the sacred tank, then offering to the place, finally the departure. After the darshan, devotees come out to the street from another route. During this time, they take part in shopping, eating, and other amusements and cultural activities. This is the typical relationship between the activity pattern and the festival, irrespective of what kind of god, what kind of religion, which kind of place. It is irrespective, because they make it the festival, the temporary festival, makeshift sacred places actually can bring together these constituents. To me, this place-specific culture in Sundarban is the central idea that comes out of its festivals and related discourses. Such a culture in the region is formed by relationship between five key elements. or components. One is religion, ritual, narrative, occupation, and nature. And if we look at the interrelationship, I go back and use that Cartesian graph which I have used right in the beginning and see how this interrelationship happens. So if we see that there are layers, like this, for example, this is the ritual layer, which happens between the environment. So ritual is related to the community as well as to the environment. Then we have the narratives. So these are almost like layers, the narratives. Then there are religion. And their interconnections in between. These five elements are built around certain loosely structured yet connected phenomena. A rich body of mythological narratives are handed down verbally and sometimes textually from a generation to generation. So that creates the culture. Symbols, rituals, and icons from various religions are included and appropriated to make folk icons. In the process, Puranic gods also got transformed into vernacular cults. There are a lot of discussions on that. Myths are constructed and rituals are practiced for divine help to protect people from high occupational risk. So the kind of pujas they do, kind of rituals they do, most of them are connected with their occupation. Alternative power discourses also emerge consequently between the caste group and so on and so forth. Religious groups also coexist socially and share similar occupation that requires close contact with nature. So when they go for the occupation, their team, the group, cuts across the religious and caste base. With the imminence of disasters, the unique and place-specific culture will be wiped out once for all, because there's a major environmental issues here, and cannot possibly be recreated simply because the culture of Sundarbans is and historically has been founded upon the negotiation community has with the nature around. So that is the essence of it, the kind of negotiation it has through its through the nature, through the occupation, through the rituals, through the religious customs, that forms the culture of Sundarban. Thank you.
I do have a question, Dr. Vipas, and that is, you know, I presume you have been to Bangladesh also, to the Sundarbans on that side of the border, you have been there, and how different are they culturally from our part of the Sundarbans?
It's almost similar. I mean, there's hardly any difference because the tiger also goes the
same. Yeah.
And the trees also the similar.
How right you are.
And the people are also quite similar, but the customs also are similar to an extent because now in Bangladesh, the most of this Gaji, and there are two kinds of important folk icons. One is Hindu kind of folk icons, one is Gaji Baba kind of, which are like Muslim icons.
Yes.
So in Bangladesh, there are more of these Muslim icons, which are more popular because of the religious base.
Yes.
But there are a lot of Hindu icons also, obviously, are there. So this, I don't see any difference as such.
But there isn't any of this religious madness either on our side or on their side?
Not at this level. I mean, where there is a life is at stake, then there is...
No, of course. But you don't see all this rubbish that's going on these days over there?
I have not seen there.
Wonderful.
Is born baby also revered in the Bangladesh side?
Sorry?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
You know, I like the title you have given, Culture of Festivals. Instead of there, all the time we see festival of the different cultures. Okay. And it's a wonderful title. Now, I was in Sundarbans just last December, 2018. I took a launch for 2 nights across the whole of the 500 kilometers. They went from one way and they came around the other side. And we were put on these, you know, what are they called? Where you watch the tiger, but we didn't see any tiger.
We
were people from Gujarat. There were some people from Bangalore. And there was an Australian couple, elderly couple. There was me. And we were all in cabins, different cabins. They have family cabins and they have individual cabins also, and it was very interesting to go around the whole river. And the man explained to us how the five rivers, converge at a point. It was so beautiful.
And that's all huge.
And then he says, it all converges, they all meet at this end, madam, and they all go down into the Bay of Bengal. Yeah, yeah. It was the most beautiful scene, lovely scene. And I think I now get the thing which you've shown us in pictures. I was only visually seeing through while the launch was going around the Sunderbans. Thank you, it was fascinating. Yes.
Doctor, I have one more question. You see, you've only seen the pug marks of the tiger. But they also talk of man-eating tigers there and there, because
yes.
The population is so dense.
Yes, yes.
So and how do you reconcile the two, surely?
Actually, the tiger is a center point of most of the myths which are created here. Like Bonbibi is one. I mean, everybody wants to get saved from the tiger. Yeah. So various icons are created, myths are created, so on and so forth. So in this area which I was showing, there it's a long area actually. Sundarban, in the width of Sundarban from eastern to the western side will be about 200 to 50 kilometer. So in that some part of Sundarban, which is northern side, north 24 Parganas side, that those areas, there is a small river in between. In Sundarban, Sundarban tigers also can swim.
Yeah, yeah.
Because there's always this high tide and low tide, and they know how to swim. So even the large rivers also they can swim in. And there are a lot of myths. And in the evening, if you start sitting with local people, there are a lot of stories. And you will get scared going out. And they will not mention tiger. They will say, oh, they, and something like some third person kind of a thing. So in some part of Sundarban, there is a small river, and during actually the breeding time, some of the tigresses actually come in and hide in within the agricultural field. And that is how, and that is the time they're weak. They cannot maneuver movement and all. That's the time when there is a possibility of man-eating kind of thing.
Otherwise, there's ample prey. The ample breeding season. There is no such man-eating
at all. No such thing, and it is also guarded. I mean, it is also fenced. So that is why it is not like a Kanha or some other forest where you can get in. Yeah. You cannot get in the forest. Unless a tiger comes out, you cannot see the tiger. It's
on
very
both
different.
Sides, so on this side and
yes,
side.
Yes, same thing. Absolutely same geography.
Thank you so much. You mentioned about Marichapi.
Yeah, yeah.
Now, what is the contemporary engagement with Marichapi on the part of people and also the activist and academic community? And if there is any reflection of that in the space itself, in the cultural space there. My second query is that you mentioned about, for example, negotiations of community with nature. Now, these negotiations, how it happens at the inter-community level, and you know, the community itself is not a homogeneous community. It has many kinds of, you know, strands of stratification, and how does it play out? Secondly, that in the context of growing climate change, and that in what way there is a new kind of creativity in engagement with nature, if any, and if that is getting any manifestation in the festival culture.
A lot of very complicated questions. Marichapi is, I'll just touch upon that because it's a long discussion in Marichapi. Marichapi is a story. There's a Dalit group of refugees from Bangladesh who came, and they settled in Chhattisgarh area. That was the beginning, because suddenly I saw some of the Bengali refugees being discovered in UP also very recently. So these are the people who were settled in Dandokaranya, and which is a very difficult place for them to stay. And they came to West Bengal thinking that there is a left-front government and they will come and stay there and they will house the refugees. And then they went to a place, Marichapi Island, and they gave the name to the island is Netaji Subhash Bose Island. Everywhere now, you know, now somebody has suggested that some university will be named. So Netaji is a political kind of a icon in that way. You know, people use it in their convenience. So that time, this since the UNESCO process was going on and this getting into this conservation process, the wildlife process was going on. West Bengal government was very much adamant, or they were like ham.
Which year is that? Around which year?
This is 80s, the late 78, 80, around that. So then they actually evicted them from that land. They didn't want to get out of that place. So many of them died. They fell into the river, and so on and so forth. So that is how it happened. And beyond, after that, there was some discussions also on that Morichappi. Mainstream Sundarban local people are not really, they are not talking about. I have not really seen anybody talking about Morichappi as such, because that happened in one place, and this is happening, I mean, because Sundarban has three different regions very clearly. So not too many people are aware of it at this point of time. Mainstream media, at some point, they really discuss. There's a movie made, there are a lot of books written, things that are like that. But at the local level, I don't think there's a much of repercussion at this point of time. Second thing, what you are saying, that because of the climate change, how the community level interactions happen. So most of these things, there are two, three things in occupationally. For example, there are three kinds of occupations happen. Most risky is the wood cutting. So one needs to go to the forest, cut the wood. Not really most risky. Most risky is honey gathering, because one has to get into the deep into the forest to get the honey. So those are the activities done by young men across religion. Whereas there are other kinds of activities which are being done because of the fisheries. They call a prawn collection, small prawn collections. They collect it, they sell it, and they make a lot of money out of it. And those are the ones which are done by women, children, and also the old people who do not have that kind of power to get into the forest and all that. And it happens across the religion. So in terms of difficulties, they select the occupation. In terms of climate change, I don't think there's the way the sophisticated climate change discussions happens in this kind of forum is actually they are following it. But the way they know the place, the breeds, when to do the fishing, when to do the cutting and all that, their understanding of the nature is quite, in that sense, is almost on their thumbs. So that is how I will put it. Put this thing in the perspective. I don't know whether I have answered your questions.
We have time for just one last question. You're talking of the high light tide and low tide. You know, this there was a little mud island across halfway of the river, Sunderbans, and this our launch got stuck over there. So I said, what is this? How long are we going to be here? He said, we don't know. We are waiting for the high tide. This is low tide, we can't move, and the launch can't move either, we need water. So I said, supposing a tiger comes across, wades across, he said, no, it's never happened, it will never happen. The tigers know launches go up and down, and they never attack the passengers, even many launches left. And you know, in the middle, we saw another launch with the flag of India. I said, but we are on Indian soil, why are they flying the Indian flag? So he said, because we are very close to the Bangladesh border,
yes, yes.
They have to fly their Bangladesh flag if they are.
Yes, yes.
We have a gentleman that wants to ask a question.
Yeah.
Last question,
Hi, Subtendu, really a big learning lesson today. My question is, how far the modernity is getting into it, to this place, the influence of, you know what I'm asking.
Yes.
We have mobiles there?
Mobiles in some places, yes, nowadays. Some places no, because you don't get the tower there, that becomes difficult. But with Jio coming in, they are getting into everybody's pocket. So I have not seen that very recently, but I'm talking about a couple of years back. There are some areas we cannot get the tower, and some areas you can. So that is the mobile part. Other part is this, I was showing the those huts and things like that. There is always an ambition in this rural part of India is to have an RCC roof, and there are a lot of RCC coming in. I mean, I'm talking about, because you are an architect, we are talking about in seeing there are tiger funds, tiger projects, in which the buildings are being built in RCC, and people are very happy with that because they think that now they have a roof on that. So that is another part. The third part is the launch which is coming, which is also environmentally problematic in the sense that the way the diesel and all that things happen. And that is the modernity part. Another one interesting point I would mention before concluding. Sometimes the development, because I said that there are a lot of rivers and they are not connected, so the bridges are built. So what happened? In the development happened, people entered in, transport system improved, but the fishermen and also the boatmen at that point of time, they were totally jobless. So now the boat is of no meaning, and then they had these engines, that motorboat kind of thing in between towards the end part, later part. And now what they are doing, that this motorboat, they are taking into a large cycle they call fatfati. I mean, there's a motorcycle in which there is a kind of a seating arrangement. So then the boat becomes the fatfati, which actually runs in a oil which is adulterated. So you have a development which is a bridge on which you are connecting people, on which you have this kind of adulterated, polluting kind of fuel. So you know, these are sometimes paradoxical things which happen also with modern encroachment and engagement.
So marine pollution, so वैसे ही बहुत खराब है ना?
हाँ, that
is. Marine diesel engines.
Mm-hmm. Yes, yes.
Ships are highly polluting.
Yes, absolutely. Yes, that is true.
So road traffic is better.
Yes, to an extent. Yes.
Yeah, I would be very happy. 4,000 was